days during our pep rallies. And so I encourage you, if you're in the neighborhood before any home game on a Friday at noon, please come by and you can check it out. As most of you know, this is our annual event, typically held in the fall when we come together to focus on the commitment to student life, our organizational successes and achievements, and begin contemplating how we can best step into the future. This event is symbolic of the flexibility needed to roll with the unpredictability of the pandemic. Last year, we had this event. We moved it to the spring because we were hoping we could do it in person. And this year, we expected to be in person as well, but we opted for a virtual event. So again, this is just symbolic of the flexibility that we're trying to embrace as we continue to work through the dynamics of the pandemic. As you know, we faced many things together in the last year: the global pandemic, a national reckoning with racism and anti-Blackness, natural and man-made disasters, a loss of $147 million in non-tuition revenue, a 20 times increase in the demand for the Bear Pantry, 155% increase in the Center for Student Conduct cases, 39% increase in student legal services consultations, and of course, I could go on and on. And yet, as a division, as a community of educators, we've risen to the challenge. We've awarded more than $330 million in aid to close to 17,000 undergraduate students and close to 7,000 graduate students. And also, on our first day of disbursements this fall, we disbursed $20 million more to approximately 2,200 students on the same as compared to the same day last year. Since spring of 2020, we've awarded over $50 million in federal, state, and local relief funding to students, including over $2.5 million from the donor-supported Student Emergency Fund. We've had 120,000 COVID tests. 97% of our students and 91% of our staff and faculty are compliant with the vaccine mandates. Over 10,000 pieces of technology hardware have been loaned since the Student Technology Equity Program, or STEP, was launched in July of 2020. Oh, and by the way, students did graduate and receive their degrees. So these are lots of facts and figures that I share with you. This next slide, you see Crystal Carpintero. She is standing in front of a building at Foothill. She is our lead isolation coordinator. When I see staff like Crystal, I think it's a clear reminder that we owe so much gratitude to so many staff members who have been on campus throughout the entire pandemic. Folks from University Health Services, Residential Life, Cal Dining, Cal Housing, Facilities, Early Childhood Education, the Student Union, Rec Sports, Cal One Card, Student Affairs Business Operations, Student Affairs IT, and more. Everyone has been coping with numerous challenges while also trying to support students. Everyone is doing more with less, and of course, struggling with things like burnout. You know, I see you, I know it's there, I hear about it every single day. Today, our theme is Reflect, Rebuild, and Restore. This really is an opportunity for us to reflect on what we've been through and accomplished, an opportunity to assess what we have and how we can rebuild, and also together restore our campus community and our own well-being. Today's goal is really simple. We want you to feel inspired to continue supporting both our students and each other. I'm excited to discuss many topics today. Let me just give you a quick overview of our program. We're going to start off with Tobirus Newby, who's a licensed clinical social worker with University Health Services. He's going to reflect on the past year and our path forward. We're going to hear some reflections from three students. We're going to have a student performance, which I think is always a highlight of our annual event. I'm going to give some remarks on rebuilding with an opportunity for questions and answers at the end. And we're also going to have a panel on focusing on restoring our campus community. It's going to be moderated by Mari Knuth-Bouracee, who's the director of the Path to Care Center. Dania Matos will be joining us, our new Vice Chancellor for Equity and Inclusion. Michael Liu, who is the Dean of the School of Public Health. And Amy Eva, who is the Associate Education Director of the Greater Good Science Center. Now I want to turn it over to our moderator, James Kato. James is the Assistant Director of the Center for Support and Intervention. James' current work focuses on supporting our students in crisis, but he's enjoyed contributing in various ways to student affairs in the past 7+ years he's worked with us. He started at Berkeley as a resident director in Unit 3, which is where I started when I came to Berkeley. And I also learned that he spent the best spring and summer ever in student services, launching the very first Golden Bear orientation before landing where he is now in the Center for Support and Intervention. Outside of his adventure-filled work life, James really appreciates the mundane, from noise-canceling headphones on BART to cooking a nice bowl of soup. So I am going to stop sharing my screen and then turn it over to James. James, you're up.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for that introduction, Steve. I'm really glad to be here and spending this time with all of you. I first want to acknowledge the wonderful Tamisha Ogans. She's slated to co-moderate today's program with me. Unfortunately, she regrets that she wasn't able to join me here today. I'm hoping we can run it back another time. And I'm going to do my best to channel Tamisha's energy. Before we continue, I wanted to share a few ground rules for our time together today. So please, first, keep yourself on mute unless you're speaking. Please feel free to use the chat if you wish to engage, but we won't be taking questions during the event. Please take care of your needs during this time. We have a pretty packed program. We do have a break, but it's pretty late in the program. And so do what you need to do to take care of yourselves. And then, you know, just so you know what to expect from today, we know that some of you really love Zoom breakout sessions. Our sincerest apologies. We don't have any of those planned for today. All right, so let's get to our first speaker. Our first speaker is Tobirus Newby from Social Services, the director of Social Services in University Health Services. Tobirus is a two-time Chancellor's Outstanding Staff Team Award recipient, once in 2015 for Berkeley Builds Capacity, which provided HIV prevention and substance abuse services for underrepresented and underserved students at UC Berkeley and other East Bay colleges, and once in 2018 for Pink Tank, which advocated for the health, mental health, and well-being of LGBTQ plus students and reducing barriers to service. Just this past spring, Tobirus also received an Excellence in Management Award for active and intentional engagement around diversity, inclusion, and belonging, resilience and adaptiveness, and compassion, work-life balance, and morale. We're very fortunate to have Tobirus here to speak about our experience over the past year and our path forward through a trauma-informed lens. Tobirus, please take it away.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Let me start this timer so that I will be in line with the program. Good morning, everybody. It's such a deep honor and a joy to be with you today, to have see all the faces as you scroll through the screens and to be able to connect with some of you in person again over the past couple of weeks has been a true gift. Before I jump into what I want to talk about today, let's take a moment to arrive together. This is how I start every staff meeting, is an opportunity to ring this little brass bowl here. My only encouragement during this time as I ring it three times is just to breathe, connect with your body. Extend gratitude to yourself for showing up. Extend gratitude to your colleagues, to the students, to the campus. We're all trying to figure it out, and I'd say we're doing an incredible job with what we have and with each other. So let's just take a moment to arrive together. That bell always helps me to find the spaciousness in every moment, so I hope it helps you to find that as well. Next slide, please. So Steve started us off by listing some reflections on what we've been through in the past year and a half. And, you know, I won't go through that whole list, but we know it ranges from, you know, physiological, biological, global, political, sociocultural, so many things that have had us at the precipice of despair. So many things that have driven us to the edges of our own understanding and of our existential purpose. But today I want to frame that in a way that has been helping me to really get through this pandemic and that is helping me see into the future. I started early on, particularly when I was thinking about George Floyd, historical experiences, generational experiences of anti-Black racism, and the many different impacts that so many cultures and communities nationally and around the world are experiencing. I started to lean into the work that I've done for about 20 years of trauma healing. And the first most important piece of understanding and working through trauma is to really be able to name it. So I call and I frame the time we've been through the lens of trauma with this definition. Trauma can be defined as a psychological, emotional response to an event or an experience that is deeply distressing or disturbing. It can also encompass the far extreme and include experiences that are severely damaging. It can be acute, so it can be something right in the moment that really makes us fear for our lives or well-being. It can be chronic, so something over time that we just can't seem to get out of because of the framework we find ourselves in, because of the political environment, or because of internal stressors and chronic issues. It also can be complex, mixing on many different levels of our experience. It can be historical, generational, cyclical. It can live in our bodies. It can impact how we process our thoughts and emotions, how we interact with each other, and our ability to even imagine our futures and our purpose. But the beautiful, beautiful thing about being able to name, identify, and be with our trauma is that that is the way we find our path forward, and that is the way we begin to dig into our wells of resilience. And the beautiful thing about resilience is that whether your well is deep as the ocean or a shallow little puddle, we can always build and enhance our resilience. So that is the spirit that I'm coming to you with today. I hope that what I share helps you to glean something that feeds and nurtures your spirit as we work with the challenge of burnout, as we work with the challenge of competing demands, as we work, you know, to really be there for our students and each other. I hope something today really inspires and shines light on how you can find a deeper path forward towards healing, resilience, and restoration. The Substance Abuse and Mental Health Services Administration has given us some ideas about what a trauma-informed approach looks like. And when I teach or when I give presentations, I really love to frame things not only through a lens of trauma-informed, but also through a lens of cultural humility and that mindset that we can always learn from each other and learn together. When we think about this first area of a trauma-informed approach, we start with safety, and oh my goodness, if safety hasn't been at the top of our minds, right, for a year and a half, is it safe to go to the grocery store? Do I need to wash this bag in this box? Who touched this handle? Where is my hand sanitizer? You know, we have dealt with so many concerns about physiological and biological safety that it really can impact how we move through the world. That also impacts our emotional well-being. And so with each of these domains, I'm just gonna ask a simple question. This is an opportunity to foster deeper conversation with yourself and with each other. So when we think about safety, what do you need to feel safe in your work? Not only outside, but inside. The next domain, trustworthiness and transparency. I have appreciated so much the emails and the messages from People and Culture, from the Chancellor, from Steve, really trying to help us to find our path forward, to name what we're experiencing, and also help us continue with our mission. What is so important in this time of sometimes disillusionment, confusion, is that we have something concrete to really stand on. And when that concrete is absent, how do we come together even in our not knowing? And what's so important in that is that we are transparent with each other about our process, about our thoughts, and that helps us to build deeper and deeper trust. So I have two questions in this domain. What do you need to see and know to be able to trust more deeply? And for those of us who are leaders of staff, of students, what can we share with our teams to enhance their sense of trust in us and in the system? Peer support. You know, being physically separated from our colleagues has been challenging, you know, and while it has been encouraging for some of us who love being in our homes, you know, it's like, yeah, I'm just in the home, this is cute, you know. It also has created like challenges with how do we connect with each other and how do we find the support we need. And as we all deal with and heal from the trauma differently, it is so important that we find our way back to each other so that we can learn and broaden our perspective as we move forward. So the question here is, what support do you need from your peers? and what support are you able to give to your peers? The next domain, collaboration and mutuality. In times of crisis, we can often go within, and I like to call it our default setting. So if we tend to be more introverted, we go way deep in. If we tend to be more extroverted, we find ourselves running a million miles a minute. But in this time, as we are coming back together, as we are learning old and new systems, a question I offer is, what do we need to reach across levels, silos, and experiences so that we can foster deeper understanding and camaraderie? How do we offer grace to each other? And how do we ask for the grace that we need in this process? Empowerment, voice, and choice. We have experienced mandates, you know, shelter in place orders, and we've heard competing narratives and voices and perspectives about the pandemic and our life in general. With all of that, how can you make your voice heard? What would help you in this moment to feel more empowered, to feel more seen? For those of us who are leaders, how can we leverage our power and influence for the good of the folks we lead and for the good of the students we serve? Last domain, cultural, historic, and gender issues. They continue to exist. They continue to permeate through us at the intersection of our identities, at the intersection of us reckoning with our history, depending on what groups we're a part of. And so as we really continue to lean into diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging initiatives, a question is, what part can you play in honoring the experiences of folks who look and experience the world differently than you? For those of us who are leaders, how can we actively diversify our perspectives and our leadership teams? Next slide, please. So this is something I just wanted to share under the domain of safety that I gleaned from B'nai Gatzert over here at UHS, that this is our process sometime of a continuum of moving through what safety can look like. At one level, the question is, do we feel included? The next level, as we feel more safe, do we feel like we can learn and absorb from the space we're in? Next, do we feel like we can give and share in this space? And then last, do we feel safe enough to challenge, you know, and to be curious about, why is this the direction we're moving? And can we do that with respect and with openness? And as we feel senses of safety, we're able to move along this continuum in a more bold way. And so we go back to that question, what do we need to feel included, to feel like we can be a learner and a contributor, and to feel like we can offer opposing views with deep respect and also an openness to continue to learn? Next slide, please. So through the lens of our organization, SAMHSA offers us some tips on how organizations and we as a system can continue to support each other through vicarious trauma, you know, direct trauma and burnout. First of all, once we realize the impact of trauma, then we can recognize how it is manifesting in ourselves and in our community, which then enables us to respond with deep intention, compassion, and clarity of heart and mind. We are then better equipped to resist and transform priorities, processes, and practices that may contribute to re-traumatization. So as we continue to rebuild and restore, let us do all that we can within ourselves, on our teams, and as leaders to be mindful about the impact of trauma, to recognize how it shows up, to respond with kindness, and to resist the things that will reactivate and exacerbate trauma in our experience. Next slide, please. So I want to invite us as we come to near the end of my talk today, let's just take a deep breath in together. And let's release the breath. As we move through trauma and dig into our resilience, our breath is one of the greatest gifts we have to find ourselves, to ground ourselves, and even if we're floating a little bit, to acknowledge where we find ourselves in the world. So as we think about how do we care for ourselves through this, I want to first of all give a shout out to Alfred Day, who is the first person I heard mention this concept of institutional care, which for me, I was like, yes, that's been the piece. Yes, I focus on self-care as a clinician, as a therapist, particularly a therapist who works with trauma. But the important piece of that is, how does my community, how does the institution, how do we as colleagues come around each other to support what self-care looks like? As you ground in what you need, here's some question for you. What nourishes your mind, your body, your spirit, and your environment? And I always assess my wellness through that lens. When I look at my environment, if it's a mess, I'm like, ooh, that might be a mirror for what's going on inside. So let me see if I can help organize these things a little bit. When I mean spirit, that can mean spirituality, but what I mean is our connection to self and others. How is that feeling? How is your body responding? And I know we deal with different levels of chronic, you know, body issues or emergent or acute. So what does our body need to feel nourished? And in a space, in a campus where we're getting so much information, how do we really, you know, engage in mindfulness about what we take into our mind and what we put out from our mind and body? Next, what do you need from and in your workplace to support your self-care efforts? What do you need for the institution to help come around your self-care needs? How can you communicate those needs? Where can you be flexible, and what feels essential? And next, be able to identify, work with your colleagues, reach out and find the resources and utilize them. There's so many resources. The deeper, you know, we dig into it, the longer I'm at this institution, the more I realize that is available to us. And even if it's not the perfect fit, it can help us find a better and a better route towards our healing and our resilience. Next slide, please. So this is a paradigm that I have been using since I became a manager a couple years ago. And you can put at the end of this diamond, whatever values or concepts work for you. But for me, I always ask myself the question, am I acting through love or through fear? I always ask myself the question, is this a place where I can leverage power for the sake of justice? And whatever the question is there, then I ground in what is my practice around how I live my life. Maybe that's a spiritual practice. Maybe that's a movement practice. Maybe that's just a decision tree. But in these domains, how do we walk to be our best self and to embody our best values? And share this with people. I'm sharing it with y'all now so that y'all know as I walk through decisions, this is what I'm asking myself. Am I leading through love or through fear? Am I making this decision through love or through fear? Am I listening with an ear of love or an ear of fear? Am I standing in power only, or am I standing in community? Am I recognizing my privilege and positionality? Am I fighting for justice? As y'all hear, that is my chime saying I'm at 15 minutes. I hope that something that was shared today is a blessing to your heart and to your soul. And I hope this is a continuation of conversations to help us continue to move forward for the honor of our ancestors, our elders, and those who have come before us, and for the good of each other and our community. The last slide is resources. Thank you very, very much.
Tobirus, thank you so much for sharing that. I especially appreciated the reminder that we ourselves can't necessarily always be personally responsible for our own wellness, and that it takes our community, it takes our colleagues at work, it takes our supervisor, manager, et cetera. So important as a reminder, thank you. I believe that we may be still setting up for our next segment. I'm waiting for a bit of a cue here, but in the meantime, I'm totally ready for this, and I'm gonna ask folks maybe to participate with me if you like. We're gonna go ahead and as long as we need to, we're gonna practice some Gen Z slang. So for those of you who are in constant contact with students, maybe this is a chance to flex your knowledge. For those of you who maybe aren't or don't have young people in your lives, maybe you might learn something. So I'm going to ask people like to just type into the chat when you've got the answer. I'm going to give you a clue, and then I want to hear what the word is, okay? We're going to start easy. The first one, feel free to type it into the chat, a really, really good song. There's two acceptable answers here, maybe. Really, really good song. So, all right, wow. This is awesome. First of all, the words that I was looking for were bop and banger. I also heard slaps, which also will count. I see a groovy tune from more than one person. Thank you, CSI and Conduct, for that. Let's see. My Jam, love that one too. It's great. Well done. All right, I think I'm gonna pass it off now. We may come back to this later, so keep your Gen Z hats on. All right, so next, whoops, one second. It's my privilege to introduce Tamisha Marsh, Fiat Lux Scholarship Program Manager in the Financial Aid and Scholarships Office. Tamisha has been at Berkeley for 5 years after joining us from a Washington, D.C. nonprofit. Tamisha is a big unapologetic fan of pineapples on pizza, which is a bold choice. Tamisha will be introducing and facilitating our student perspective segment. Tamisha, please go ahead.
Hi, everyone. Again, my name is Tamisha Marsh. My pronouns are the she series, and I am the Fiat Lux Scholarship Program Manager. The Fiat Lux Scholarship Program was founded in 2016. It is a merit and financial need-based scholarship. It covers up to the full financial need of our scholars for 4 years. The program partners with 87 high schools in California. To be considered for the scholarship, a student must attend one of these high schools. It is our mission and charge to serve underrepresented and first-generation college students in our program. We currently support 338 scholars. 58% are UROM, 75% are Pell eligible, and 73% are first-generation college students. Fiat Lux scholars receive many benefits. One notable benefit is priority class enrollment. The staff works tirelessly to support the program, which includes Andrea Bonifacio, the Assistant Director of the Financial Aid and Scholarships Office, and Yesenia Mendoza-Muller, the Fiat Lux Scholarship and Financial Aid Advisor. I would like to introduce everyone to the Fiat Lux scholars that will be speaking to you today. First, Shreejal Luitel. His pronouns are he, him, his. He is a sophomore in the College of Engineering. Angelica Garcia, her pronouns are she, her, ella. She is a sophomore in the College of Letters and Sciences. And Natalia Nava, her pronouns are she, her, hers. She is a senior at the Haas School of Business. Now, I would like to turn it over to Shreejal.
How difficult would it be for you to sit in a room for 15 minutes focusing only on your breath? Maybe give it a try tonight and notice how the mind moves from one thought to another incessantly. We have very little control over our minds, but the mind exerts a larger control over our day-to-day functions. I started practicing anapana, the mindfulness of observing our natural respiration, after my cousin from Nepal mentioned to me that it transformed his life. And in many ways, the simple technique of observing and focusing on my natural breath has transformed mine as well. Exasperated by the effects of a pandemic, dealing with family obligations, school commitments, and social distress, the mind wanders into the mist. I began to doubt my academic capabilities as a first-generation college student while taking my very first bio class at Berkeley. I felt that I didn't have it within me to pass the class. And at the time, my dad was also sick, and in the emergency room, I felt unsure of where my future was headed towards. During the past 18 months of Zoom, I've found that the sacred technique of Anapana, the mindfulness of breathing technique taught by the Buddha himself, has allowed me to clear up some of the fog and better discover the luminosity in my life. I remember the times during the first 6 months of the pandemic, where I felt a lot of anxiety because, quite frankly, my transition to Cal was a bit peculiar, and it was compounded by the lack of social interactions. I felt that I didn't have a lot of people that I could talk to about my situation, and I became really frightened about what was to come. Observing my natural respiration for 15 minutes a day transformed my life in inexplicably profound ways. When you initially attempt a technique of anapana for even 15 minutes, you'll find that each second feels like an hour, and each minute feels like an entire year. And it's important, even if it's for a little while, to take time to de-stress from the problems of everyday life by meditating. I witnessed several changes in my life post-meditation. I felt that I was more attentive in my classes, stress-free, and in many ways, empathetic towards the needs of others. Let's face it, when we're in Zoom calls, we do get the urge to check our phones, and oftentimes we do. And perhaps that's the case with some of you guys right now. I found with Anapana that I could change some of the habit pattern of my mind and just enjoy the moment for what it is, even if it's a professor ranting about their nuisance in their everyday life. I also felt a lot more stress-free. Right before an exam or before class starts, to develop a sharper focus, I practice Anapana for about 5 minutes, which helps me alleviate some of my stress and be more present in the moment. And with much of my family responsibilities through meditation, I'm beginning to realize the impermanent nature of the world. Everything is constantly changing, and I realize how far my hands can stretch. The only thing that I can control is my mind. Outside of that, I have very little control. In ways that are perhaps inexplicable, mindfulness has made me more equanimous. And to this day, I still practice Anapana. And I've recently started practicing Vipassana, which is the mindfulness of observing the sensations in my body. In many contentious situations, I've realized that I've become more tranquil, finding a peace of mind. I've begun to ask myself, in many of the things that we worry about, what really matters in the scheme of life? When I'm in my 80s, will I really think about the exam that I failed in my freshman year in college? Probably not. The only thing that matters is now. How mindful we are dictates how much we love and care about others. How much we love dictates how happy we are. And our happiness allows us to live in the moment.
Thank you, Shreejal. Next, we will hear from Angelica.
Hello, everyone. My transition and time here at Berkeley, both online and in person, cannot be possible without an energizer. Now, I'm not talking about an energizer like coffee that can keep me awake all day. I'm talking about an energizer that fuels me through the semester, that through the spaces where I fail to find people who look like me, and through the spaces where I fail to hear Spanish, and the only thing I hear is English. Berkeley is a little less than 400 miles away from where I was born and raised, which is Boyle Heights in East LA. Lucky for me, I have four energizers, each of them responsible for a fourth of the distance for every 100 miles. The first energizer is my father, mi padre trabajador, the most hardworking man I know. Every morning he wakes up at 5 a.m. to head to work. He works in a construction about an hour away from home. I know this because every time I FaceTime him in the night, he tells me how tired he is and how he has to go to sleep because he has to wake up early. Back in LA, my father would give me a kiss on my forehead to let me know that he was leaving for work. Now, because of the distance, he sends me a good morning text, asking me to take care of myself and for me to never forget how much he loves me. He tells me to go to sleep so that my cerebrote can function, so that my big brain can function. La mujer más hermosa del mundo, the most beautiful woman in the world, is my second energizer. My mother energizes me by bringing me life just like she did 20 years ago. She brings me life through laughs and tears. My mother has been through all the ups and downs of college. She is a person I call when I get accepted into an internship, when I cry because of homesickness, and when I'm in doubt because of a situation. She reminds me that the emotions I go through here at Berkeley are normal and essential to my growth. And she never goes a day without telling me how proud I make her. The third energizer is my brother, David, my little man. I remember when I carried him a few minutes after he was born. I was so happy because I was so excited to be an older sister. I knew I had to take care of him and guide him. I was actually able to pick him up on his first day of high school this June. And I almost cried because this was the first time I saw the little boy that I carried standing outside of his high school. It hit me then that he would soon be in my shoes walking around his college campus. Every time I call, he tells me how he passed his test, how he's learning X, Y, and Z, and how he soon is going to have his first cross country race, which actually is later today at 12. My brother is that reminder of who I am. I am that older sister that is navigating higher education on my own so that he won't feel lost when it's his turn. I'm getting this degree so that he can always know that he can and will become that engineer that he has always dreamed of. My last and final energizer is my twin. Now, most twins are the same age, but my twin and I have a 16-year gap. My baby sister, Valerie, is the most energetic and joyous person I know. I thought I was the loudest in the family, but she beats me. Every time I call home, she screams at my mother, asking for the phone. I want to talk to Ka. Quiero hablar con Ka. She tells me Ka because she cannot pronounce my full name. It wasn't until a few days ago that she told me, yo te quiero mucho, Angelica. I love you, Angelica. She brags to her cousins and family friends that her hermana is at Berkeley. If I were to show you a picture of my little sister and a picture of myself when I was her age at age 3, we are identical, the same smile, the same love for dancing, but she also is more than what I was. She is fearless, she is independent, and she is so, so smart. She tells me that she will go to Berkeley one day just like me. I don't know if a 3-year-old understands exactly what Berkeley is, but she tells me with so much determination that I know she will. I remember when I found out that I received the Fiat Lux scholarship, I made my whole family take a picture with me with the I committed to Berkeley poster. And in one of the pictures with my siblings, Valerie is there holding the corner of the paper with the biggest smile on her face. I always look at these pictures when I'm feeling the weight of imposter syndrome and homesickness. I shared with my parents a poem I wrote about healing in my Chicano R1A class, about how I will heal myself, I will heal my undocumented parents, my brother, and my sister. My family energizes me to obtain this healing. The healing I am searching for is not in the form of pills. It is in the form of my ideas, my ambition to become a high school college advisor so I can help other low-income, first-generation students of color get into spaces like Berkeley, to help my brother become the engineer he wants to be, to guide my sister's curiosity and give back to my parents who have sacrificed everything for me. They are my energy and constant reminder of my purpose every single day. Every single time I see the photos on my wall as I do my homework from my desk, every time I check my phone and see Valerie smiling right back at me. Mi familia es mi energía, and without them, I wouldn't be able to present here as a Fiat Lux scholar. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Angelica. Finally, we'll hear from Natalia.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you for being here today. Back in spring of 2020, after the school closed down, I moved back to my hometown of Salinas, California. I settled into the room that I grew up sharing with my sister, and on our bedroom door hung a poster with a CSU system logo. Throughout middle and high school, that poster was my daily reminder that I wanted to do my best in all the different endeavors I was taking on in order to achieve the goal of attending college, which was something very new to me being a first-gen student. During the pandemic, as I was taking my online classes, I would see this poster and it no longer was serving its original purpose. The poster was becoming more of a source that made me reflect upon my role as a student at UC Berkeley. During the pandemic, I would often reflect and recognize that throughout my time at Cal, since I was a freshman, I had this belief that overworking was the only way I would survive and thrive at Cal. I used to think that one mistake could ruin my chances of preparing for my future after college, because getting into Cal was one thing, but being able to finish Cal was another thing. So throughout my first 2 years at Cal, I accepted those thoughts and they were always living at the back of my mind. During the pandemic, however, I realized that those ideas weren't healthy, that they were not allowing me to really grow academically and professionally as I was starting to end my time at Cal. So accepting the fact that my way of thinking was not healthy during the pandemic, it took a toll on me because I was trying to change that mindset. Meanwhile, also trying to be a supportive sister to my 3 younger siblings, being a supportive daughter to my parents who were still working during the pandemic, and, you know, just having that that kind of fear of like, oh, they still need to be out there. Like it's not a choice, it's just a have to. And just trying to be a supportive friend and a supportive leader within groups that I'm a part of. So during 2020, yes, I was on this mission to grow my mindset. So I tried to find actionable steps that I could take to develop a stronger mental well-being. I tried to read some books from psychologists and figure out what I can do to have more of a balance as a student, as a friend, and a community leader on school clubs like the Latino Business Student Association and Paragon Consulting. Those are spaces that I am currently a part of. To this day, I am continuously working on finding that right balance, even as a senior, as we start to navigate finding jobs and figuring out what we're doing after college. These past few weeks, being back on campus, I have felt energized when I'm surrounded by fellow leaders within the organizations I am a part of. Together, we're working towards the same goal of uplifting underrepresented communities through the UC Berkeley campus. As vice president at the Latino Business Student Association, I work alongside amazing students and we provide resources and services to really help students prepare for a career in business or entrepreneurship. And as vice president at Paragon, I'm very energized right now because we work alongside students to provide pro bono consulting to small businesses here in the Bay Area. And given the circumstances and the challenging times, it's really great to be able to support them in that sense during these times. So as a student leader on campus, I am empowered when sharing space with fellow students who are also navigating classes, meanwhile, going towards this goal of uplifting underrepresented communities on our campus. I do envision a future where students who come from similar backgrounds like mine continue leading organizations and continue sharing conversations with administration leaders so that together we can listen to student needs and help them complete their degrees to prepare for a future career. Thank you.
Thank you to the Fiat Lux scholars for sharing their reflections over the last 18 months. We appreciate and value all of your experiences. We also appreciate the organizers of this event for giving us the opportunity to share information about the Fiat Lux Scholarship Program. Thank you to everyone in Student Affairs that has supported our scholars over the years. I will now turn it back to James.
Thanks. Thank you, Tamisha, and thank you, Shreejal, Angelica, Natalia, for those really powerful stories. So valuable to hear your voices in this space. We're running just a minute ahead of time. Well done, everyone. So we're gonna do another slang term. I do want to recognize Summer Jackson and Jed Lee, who I think were quickest on the trigger last time. With bop and banger. This one, I'm gonna up the difficulty a little bit. So this time, we're looking for two words, one phrase for, I not only agree with this sentiment, but I really, really relate to it right now. I'm seeing a lot of slang words that I don't know. This is very helpful for me too. I'm gonna need to start looking some of these up. Ah, Holly hit it. The word that I was looking for was big mood. This is a fun one to use. When you see something that's relatable, saying mood. And if you find it really, really relatable, big mood. Well done, Holly. All right, let's keep going. Next up, we have a student video performance that we're excited to share and highlight. Founded in 2005, Cal Raijin Taiko is Berkeley's premier Japanese drumming performance ensemble. With a repertoire consisting entirely of original compositions, Cal Raijin Taiko performs to spread the knowledge, love, and passion of Taiko to both the campus and the surrounding communities. Whether it be practicing at night around campus or performing at events such as the homecoming rally, Cal Taiko is excited to have become a regular part of campus activities.
Hi.
Okay, I gotta get the screen bigger. How do I get the screen bigger?
All right. Hope you enjoyed that. Energy. We're going to move straight into our address. We're going to have Vice Chancellor Steve Sutton share comments. A few fun facts about Steve. So excited for this. Steve says that he fully embraces the learner theme of his StrengthsQuest typology. And a couple of the latest things he's learning about are growing vegetables in a garden that he built and practicing meditation. He is also still committed to his long-standing hobby of photography. After Steve's address, he's going to answer questions that were submitted via the State of the Division RSVP form. And we're going to get through as many of those as we can in the time that we have today. Over to you, Steve.
Great. Thank you, James. Appreciate it. You did a great job as our moderator. I'm going to focus on the rebuilding or rebuild part of our theme. I've been thinking a lot, like I'm sure everyone has, just trying to make sense of what we've been going through and how to make things better, not only in my own life, but for what I do through my work. This has brought me back to student development theory. Student development theory is something that I started my career 30 years ago. I spent a lot of time just trying to think about how I could take the theoretical perspectives that I had learned and then applying them in a real way to have a positive impact on students. And speaking of my career, this is my ID card from when I started at Berkeley many, many years ago, 1987. I still have that ID card. Yes, this means I'm a pack rat. But simply, I share this with you because I've been having the opportunity to really work with theory for a very, very long time. And so I want to start by looking at a simple environmental theory. This is Kurt Levine's behavioral theory. And this is pretty straightforward. It states that an individual's behavior, or B, is a function, F, of the person, P, including their history, personality, and motivation, and their environment, or E, which includes both their physical and social surroundings. So why is this important for us today? This is why it's important for us today. So the environment that we all have been living in has been just changing dramatically. Our physical and our social environments. We heard a little bit of this from all of our speakers so far. Tobirus talked about this. Our students talked about this. You know, what our environments were, what we were expecting them to be, they weren't what we expected them to be. In some ways, they were better. In other ways, they were not better. And so students, you know, are expecting, for example, to leave their homes with their families and come to Berkeley. And for many students, that did not happen. They ended up staying in their homes and trying to manage all the things that they needed to manage so they could still be successful as students. I want to share with you a story about Kaylee Chen. Kaylee is graduated as part of the class of 2021 as a legal studies major. She debated on whether to come back to school for the fall of 2020. A quote we have from Kaylee: "I still remember when I got the notification the class was going to be canceled, which I thought at the time was just going to be an extra long spring break." Obviously, she's referring back to March when the pandemic just started. But she did choose to come back. She did return. She returned to her job as an RA. She used Xfinity and HBO Max to keep herself entertained during the self-sequester. She hosted virtual trivia nights with her four mates. She continued working remotely in her campus job with Student Affairs Communications. She had grab-to-go options from the dining halls and Golden Bear Cafe and ate on Memorial Glade with her bubble. She learned about virtual offerings, on-demand fitness classes from Rec Sports, virtual ceramics from the art studio, Cal Sports, quiz nights. She had virtual hangouts on Zoom to stay connected with her friends who were states away. She used our Career Services Center and was able to secure multiple job offers by March. She graduated with high distinction this May. And she currently is a legal assistant at the Brattle Group, which is a global consulting firm. And all these things were enabled through the support that we were able to provide her in student affairs. And so, again, this is a congratulations to everyone that was involved, everyone that worked to provide the support to Kaylee. So what was happening from a theoretical perspective? This is Vincent Tinto's theory of student departure. It's another theory that's been around a really long time. And as you can see there, you know, one of our primary objectives is to help students stay at Cal and succeed. We don't want them to come to Cal and leave. You know, and many students do leave multiple institutions and from across the country and for all kinds of different reasons. But one of the things that I think is really important is to focus on this part of this theoretical perspective here, and that is the academic integration and social integration. And so this is what, when I was reading to you about Kaylee's story, this is what was happening. She was becoming socially integrated into our community. And so again, we use these theories as a way to guide our actions, but it's really the ultimate outcome of helping students succeed, helping them explore their identities, helping them learn to live in an autonomous way, learning to live in a global society. All these things have a theoretical perspective, and then it's our division that then actually then brings them to life and makes them happen. You may recognize this structure. This is a picture that's again, an old photo. Here's what that structure looks like today. It's the Bay Bridge. This is about change and rebuilding from a physical perspective. Another image for you, you may know this as well. And there's what it looks like today. These are the New Orleans levees. I show you these visible representations of rebuilding because this type of rebuilding takes years and in many cases with tremendous expense. Our type of building, rebuilding, is very different, though just as difficult. Unlike an earthquake or physical buildings, our physical buildings are still intact, but the pandemic has rocked our emotional foundation, our routines, traditions, relationships, in many cases, our spirits have suffered as a result of the pandemic. And the heroic work that we have done so far has led to staff burnout. All of our successes have taken a toll on someone or somewhere within our organization. And as an optimist, I believe we can rebuild even better than before. We've already found ways to improve our services. Not only have we adapted to the pandemic, but we've rebuilt our processes, our programs, and our services to better serve our students. Cal Student Central, for example, has created a more student-friendly website. They have a virtual front desk where they've had over 4,000 visits, and a chatbot tool which is available 24/7, 365. Golden Barrel Orientation pivoted quickly and offered a hybrid experience, and also featured programs for second year students. So for our students who did not get the traditional orientation, you know, students who are now our sophomore students. The Career Center has online career fairs. They've had over 900 employers, 71,000 jobs and 25,000 internships posted in Handshake. The Center for Educational Partnerships, welcome to them. This is their first state of the division, being in our division, joined us this past spring. And they have been continuing their great work, preparing K-12 and community college student transfers to apply to universities and make their college dreams come true. And I could go on. We have University Health Services where they have pivoted and really focused on telehealth and not only providing support for medical visits, but also for mental health support as well. Path to Care created a new resource for managers on relationship violence during the pandemic. Student Affairs Communications launched the Berkeley Life Platforms. The Roundup email reaches 60,000 students plus each month, 31,000 page views on the blog. Instagram has over 6,000 followers. Rec Sports has had 55,000 live virtual fitness classes attendees and more than 7,500 on-demand fitness class views. So, and of course this semester they're back in person. Rec Sports, UHS, the School of Public Health and Physical Education program received a gold level distinction for creative adaptation to physical activity programming during the pandemic. Caltopia was in person this year at the RSF with over 8,000 attendees. Calapalooza was held virtually, but it helped connect students. They had 900 attendees connecting with over 300 organizations. So just gratitude to all these teams and also to all those who didn't have time. We didn't have time to mention, but it's just been really such a great and tremendous team effort. Now I want to talk about the strategic plan. So I'm a firm believer of the adage that if you fail to plan, you plan to fail. And so that's why our strategic plan is so critical to us. Our strategic plan kicked off in the fall of 2019. And we really were seeking to create a framework to apply to our divisional decision-making that help us identify where and how to invest our teams and our resources, and not just what we prioritize, but also what we deprioritize. And to me, this is the more difficult question. It's not so much what to do into the future, but what not to do into the future. And so we started developing our strategic plan priorities in the fall of 2019, right before the pandemic. And we've also decided to move at a little bit slower pace during the pandemic. But as you see there, we have these five critical areas: redefining the student experience, creating a culture of equity, inclusion, and belonging, health, justice, and holistic well-being, financial stability, and organizational behavior and development. I think these five priority areas really encompass the diversity and the level of influence we have as a very large division on our campus. In fact, more than half of the student affairs staff who attended the most recent roundtable that we had indicated that their work aligns with our top two priorities, which is redefining the student experience and creating a culture of equity, inclusion, and belonging. And 70% of staff have said that multiple priorities align with their work. And over half of our staff reported already working on strategic plan priorities, with another 21% indicating an interest in their work and associated with strategic plan. What this says to me is that our staff are already resonating with the strategic plan, are engaged with our work priorities, and I thank everyone for that. I'm really excited to see where this is going to go into the future. I think it's going to be a wonderful roadmap for us as we continue to expand the influence that we have on and for our students. Assessment. So in addition to having a plan, we also need to measure how we are doing. Assessment is our way to ensure that we're meeting our strategic plan priorities. And during the pandemic, we launched several student pulse surveys. These surveys, and we've talked about these before, were ways for us to track student mental health, student plans, student sentiments on our services. And we just concluded the recent pulse survey of students to gauge their perceptions about our services. Don't have the results yet. We'll share those in the near future when we have them. However, some results from the spring pulse surveys found that 91% of undergraduate and 87% of graduate students were satisfied with Cal Student Central Virtual Front Desk, for example, and that 19% of the students wanted mostly virtual services, 26% want mostly in-person services, and 31% want a mixture of in-person and virtual services. So you can see we still have some work to do in terms of finding out what it is our students want and how we can best deliver those services to them. We've also heard from a large number of students, both undergraduate and graduate students, that Zoom burnout occurs almost every single day. And of course, this is something that is true for all of us as well. On some good news, student rates of depression and anxiety leveled off, and some even decreased after the semester began. I think that is in large part due to the successes of our folks at University Health Services and Tang Center. And of course, they still remain available to support students in any way that they can. We have a Student Affairs Assessment, Evaluation, and Planning Committee. This committee is co-chaired by Dr. Jackie Thomas and Laura Balin. The committee includes Noah Henry Darwish, Rosalind Johnson, Haley Bauer, Christina Galli, Lila Naranjo, and Devin Wicks. And they are charged with helping to promote a culture of data-informed decision-making. They meet regularly, they share best practices, they're working on creating a data warehouse, and they're developing a self-study tool to help us evaluate how well we're doing with our strategic initiatives and to help us prepare for realizing our strategic plan. And then fittingly, they launched a survey to understand our current divisional assessment. So what's happening across the division, and this even included what's happening outside of our division. Once some of our campus colleagues heard about this assessment that we were doing, they wanted to become part of it too. So this is really so we can act in a smarter way as it comes to our surveying of students. And this committee will also present some results in the near future. A budget update. We try to do our best to share as much information with you as possible and as quickly as possible related to our budget. You see there, we're going to have a, we're expecting to have a budget deficit this year, a 3.2 million. That's planned for. We've worked with the campus in terms of that, and they certainly understand the situation that we're in. This compares to $112 million in revenue losses our previous fiscal year. Now, we are hopeful and fully expect to receive $20 million in federal relief funding. And also about $18 million in relief from the central campus. And we're anticipating it's going to take 3 years to balance our budget and up to 10 years to really fully rebuild our reserves. This is the issue of time I mentioned earlier when I talked about just some of the rebuilding that takes and how it takes years to rebuild bridges and levees, for example. The same is true for our reserves and the things that we need to do moving into the future. Some bright spots. I mean, we are delighted that we've been able to bring back the majority of our temporarily laid off staff. At this point, we don't anticipate additional layoffs related to our budget deficits. And we are going to continue to figure out how we can grow our revenues and also just continue to be mindful of what our current costs are and how we manage those current costs. We're also looking at how we can take advantage of the pandemic to really rebuild our budget strategy. So we've launched this divisional funding model review to really look at how we can align the budget to our strategic priorities. DEIB, this is also something that's very, very important to us as a division. You know, as we rebuild, we need to ensure that our strategies work for everyone. Laila Rangho, who is our senior advisor on equity and belonging, has done tremendous work and been in this role. We actually have a DEIB advisory board. This is 13 staff members who have the charge to advise me and my leadership team on the holistic staff experience using a DEIB lens. They meet every quarter. They provide input and guidance, draft recommendations. They help elevate staff issues and articulate the impacts that they see of the things that we're doing as a division on staff. They help us identify needs and gaps and opportunities, and also identify potential stakeholders, whether in the division or outside the division. And so I want to thank those 13 individuals for just volunteering their time for this important effort. We have a new series of training sessions coming out September 21. There's a DEIB terminology and practice training session. There's also another training on November 1st. Many departments are already working with Lila on individual committees or working in groups to make changes at the local level. We've also started a student affairs newsletter that's going to be anchored in our DEIB efforts as well. You'll hear more about that in the near future. People's Park. So People's Park is representative of the housing initiative that the chancellor has. This is a major initiative for the campus and for student affairs. You may have heard that on September 30th, the Regents voted to approve our plans for a new People's Park. There are four main elements to this project. There's a supportive housing for 40 to 50 unhoused and very low income people in our community. We're also gonna offer below market rate housing for 1,100 undergraduates and a new residence hall. We're going to preserve more than half of the site as revitalized green space that will be open and accessible to everyone. And then there's also going to be a public memorial and celebration of the park's past. And it's significant, and its significance in terms of the meaning to our community. I think this is really critical that we need to be mindful that even though we are changing the look and the use of the park, that we still be mindful and pay attribute to the history of the park. We surveyed some students about the park and their feelings about the park. This is an independent survey that was done a few months ago. And the bottom line is that 68% of students support the plan for doing something with the park, building housing there. And this transformative project is going to begin construction sometime in 2022. You may have seen this change curve sometime in the past. One of the things that I hear about probably almost every day in my work is how staff are struggling with the change that we're all going through. And this is the Kubler-Ross change curve. You see lots of different emotions here. And as mentioned before, the pandemic and our return to campus has taken a significant emotional toll. We know that people are experiencing burnouts. There's uncertainty about the future. People are looking for control in their lives. And I believe that we're all living in a big experiment right now, right? I mean, it takes, you know, years, again, to rebuild levees and bridges. We're not going to rebuild our culture, a culture that's been fractured and damaged as a result of the pandemic, in just a matter of months. It's going to take us time to work through all these issues. And it's going to be important that we support each other as much as we can and really address the issues as they come up. Some of the things we're trying to do to support staff is we're really trying to balance how we serve students and how we can support staff in order to be as successful as possible as an organization. We have new flexible work arrangements that folks have, time to use your vacation and emergency paid sick leave has been extended to June 2022. We're also trying to maintain those programs that we know have been really important to staff in the recent past, such as the $100,000 staff professional development fund that we've set aside to supplement the professional development dollars that are available in your actual unit. So this, again, is money that can be used by anybody in the division. You apply for it, you'll hear information soon about that process. And we're gonna continue to support people through online and in-person resources. The Be Well Work program and the WorkFit program are tremendous ways for staff to be able to manage the stresses that they encounter at work or at home. And so if you haven't had a chance to take advantage of those programs, I certainly encourage you to do that. The campus is also looking at new and enhanced appreciation events. We had, you know, the ice cream social this past summer on Sproul Plaza with senior leaders and gave out the commemorative pens, t-shirts and other things. Employee Appreciation Week is coming up soon, as you saw from that email from Eugene Whitlock. And so, you know, we're looking for ways that we can just use the current situation that we're in to still be able to be mindful and let folks know that we care about them and that we value the work that they do. So as I wrap up, there are two questions I want to toss out to you and invite you to ponder these. And I'm hoping that we can have conversations about these two questions at a future student affairs update or roundtable, maybe even meetings within your own unit. You can then use, you make time to talk about these questions as well. And the first was, how can we use what we've learned during the pandemic to create that academic and social integration for students? I come back to that Tinto's theory on student departure and that academic and social integration, how that's really critical in terms of leading to students being successful at Cal. And so I think we have opportunities to rethink how we can manage our services for students. How can we expand our services for students and still be able to meet the needs of staff as well? A win-win for both students and staff. Lots of organizations do creative things, whether staff work 4 10-hour days or whether they shift their hours of service really to work better for their clientele rather than having a standard 8 to 4 time frame. So yeah, I just mentioned these as examples because I really am hoping that we can create some significant dialogue within our division to think about how we can really move forward, be transformative, if you will, in terms of how we provide services to students and also support each other. Now, not all ideas are going to work for both students and staff, but I think we can reimagine and get creative together. The second question is, how do we best create a positive community among our teams in a hybrid work environment? So this isn't about insisting that people come to work every single day or promising that you can work remotely forever. It's about meeting our students where they are and understanding how best we can serve them. And that, you know, we'll use our assessment tools, as I mentioned before, to make sure we understand what students really want and need. And I'm hoping that we can also, too, as we continue to move into the future, align our community building efforts to work in new and different ways. So we can still have that sense of community not only at the unit, but also broadly across the Division of Student Affairs and still be able to meet the needs of students. So these are two questions. I hope that you'll spend some time pondering these questions yourself, talking about them in your units, and then we'll have conversations about them in the near future on a divisional level. Okay, I'm gonna stop there. James, I know you wanted to, we're gonna handle some questions.
That's right. Thanks, Steve, for all these updates. I really appreciate the ongoing transparency. And I also appreciated you bringing us back to all the ways that all of our different jobs and work connects to the bigger picture of supporting students. So yes, I do have some questions for you submitted by Student Affairs staff. I also believe that these questions will be added to the chat as we go so people can follow along. So we'll just dive right into it. So first up, what do students think about the services offered by Student Affairs and our response thus far to the pandemic?
Yeah, a great place to start, James. Thank you. You know, we have lots of information from students through these pulse surveys I mentioned before, and we administered several surveys over the past year, and we got really good response rates. I mean, we didn't get 100%, but we got as you might expect, Berkeley students, they want to tell us how they're doing. They want to be thought partners with us in terms of moving forward. And so we got lots of good information from students. And for the most part, students are satisfied with the virtual services that we're providing them. I mentioned Cal Student Central. Virtual front desk is one example. But we also hear that the students are mixed in terms of wanting virtual and in-person services. So we're gonna continue to offer both. I think we have to kind of figure out what that sweet spot is in terms of how much of each. We've heard also from students that they really value and appreciate and rate very highly goal-bearing orientation, for example. And that students, we ask them about our communications. And there's been a tremendous amount of work from Ellen Topp and her whole team on trying to make sure our communications functions pivot along with the pandemic. The 3/4 of the students really found our communications, the length to be right and the frequency to be just right. We still get feedback from students that TLDR, too long, didn't read. But for the most part, we're trying to work smarter in terms of how we communicate with them in terms of important information that they need to know. And so we really want to make sure that we're meeting students where they are and that we're delivering services when, where, and how they really need them.
Thank you. I think we'll try to get through at least one more question. Many staff are doing the work of multiple people. The change has been constant with not just changes related to the pandemic, but also reorganizations and changes in reporting lines. What are you doing to help staff that are feeling burnout? Will there be salary increases, whether for equity or to compensate for the increased workload and stress?
Yeah, thank you. And I'm sure this is probably maybe top of mind for everybody here at this meeting today. As I said before, I hear a lot about staff burnout and folks' satisfaction with their work. It's one of my biggest concerns. I talk about this with the executive team probably every single meeting that we have. We understand the pandemic has created uncertainty and stress, and most of us feel stretched thin. That's why we're promoting these flexible work arrangements, including hybrid work schedules. And we're also trying to offer online in-person resources where available. I mentioned Be Well at Work, Work Fit, Rec Sports classes, all those types of things, so that if folks are working in a hybrid model or at home, they still can tap into those programs. I'd encourage you to use sick leave and other time away that you've earned, and just work out with your supervisor, work out, you maybe talk to your HR business partner in terms of how you can use time away if you are challenged in terms of stress and it's impacting your physical health. Most of our plans moving forward are really grounded in our divisional strategic plan, which we talked about before. I think having a strategic plan is really a North Star that helps us work smarter and in a more streamlined way. And we have an opportunity to prioritize our work and challenge the status quo. Again, coming back to this idea that, what can we deprioritize? What can we stop doing? Because I think that's, to me, is again, one of the hardest questions. Again, we're trying to look at our appreciation events and how we can just do just new and different things to let people know that we support and care for them. So there's a whole bucket of things that we're trying to do. This summer, we had the general salary increase that kicked in as of July 21st for all eligible PPSM covered staff. And you know, we don't have any news yet about, I think it's still too early to know what's going to happen this next year. I mean, I can tell you that one of the things I will certainly do is advocate for an additional increase for all staff. I think it's really important to let people know that we value them, and that's a tangible way that we can do that. So we haven't heard anything, but we haven't heard anything that the raises aren't happening either.
So. Appreciate hearing that. Thank you. I think that's all the time that we have. So we're going to stop here. We're about to send people to a break. Let's see. Yeah, we've got a 5-minute break. We hope that during this time you take care of yourselves, and we hope that you enjoy meeting your colleagues' pets on screen. Thanks, Steve, for your address and for answering these questions. When we come back, Mari Knuth-Bouracee will be facilitating our community restoration panel, featuring some awesome campus leaders. We will see you in 5.
para limpiar las heridas. A veces solo una gota puede vencer la sequía. ¿Y para qué?
Back in 1 minute, folks.
No, don't turn it off. I want to keep dancing. That's my salsa time.
All right, welcome back, everyone. Really appreciated the energy during that break. All right, next, it's my pleasure to introduce Mari Knuth-Bouracee, who will be facilitating today's final panel. Mari provides oversight and leadership for the Path to Care Center. She's deeply committed to social justice, access to education, eliminating all forms of violence and oppression, and has a strong background in creating inclusive environments and leading transformational change. Prior to joining UC Berkeley, Mari worked with campus women's centers, community and university response teams, and as a consultant for equity and inclusion. Her scholarship focuses on critical praxis, violence prevention, norms and pro-sociality, and equity in education and workplaces. Mari, please go ahead.
James, thank you so much for the introduction. Colleagues, it's been a tremendously difficult year. Many of our student stories highlighted that. And this last year and a half is also compounding the many tragedies, pains, and traumas we've wrestled with over the course of our lives. As a division, we have been apart or otherwise functioning in new ways, different ways, many of us working on campus throughout the pandemic, others working remotely, and there have certainly been very limited opportunities for us to come together. And one thing is clear, that while we globally have shared collective traumas, we've also each had unique and singular experiences. And so as we reflect, rebuild, and restore, this panel is really going to be focused on that restore theme. And we'll be discussing how to approach and what to consider as we consider restoring, how to restore ourselves and do so intentionally with community. And I'm thrilled to introduce this esteemed panel. So I'm going to share with you, they have all done amazing things. And so I'm going to get to share with you a lot about their background before I start asking them questions. So with us today, we have Michael Liu, Amy Eva, and Dania Matos. Michael is the current dean of the UC Berkeley School of Public Health, and he is a graduate of the UC Berkeley-UCSF Joint Medical Program. He has decades of experience as a professor of public health, as well as obstetrics and gynecology, and a proven record of academic and national executive leadership, as well as a deep-rooted passion for health equity and social justice. Michael was the director of Maternal Health and Child Health, Maternal and Child Health Bureau for the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services, which served more than 57 million women, children, and families. During his tenure, he transformed key programs and was awarded the Humphrey Award for Service to America. He has dedicated his research to the development, testing, and translation of new theory on the origins of maternal and child health disparities. And he's best known for his research on racial ethnic disparities in birth outcomes from a life course perspective. As an obstetrician, Michael has attended over 1,000 births and has been voted one of the best doctors in America since 2005. Welcome, Michael. Next, I'll introduce Amy. Amy Eva is the Associate Education Director at the Greater Good Science Center. She writes for the center's online magazine, facilitates the Summer Institute for Educators, and creates online resources for educators. She is one of the key developers of the website Greater Good in Education, which is focused on creating kinder and happier schools. With over 25 years in the classrooms, she is a teacher at heart, fascinated by the psychology of learning and students' social emotional development. She became particularly passionate about educator resilience and self-care, and she loves to conduct workshops that focus on teacher well-being. As a researcher, Amy has published in the areas of teacher education, metacognition, adolescent mental health, and mindfulness interventions with marginalized youth. She received her PhD in educational psychology from the University of Washington, where she worked with high school students in language art classes, helping them draw their emotional responses to poetry to guide their understanding and to enhance their appreciation of literature. Welcome, Amy. And finally, I'd like to introduce Dania Matos. After a national search, Dania was recently appointed Vice Chancellor for the Division of Equity and Inclusion here at UC Berkeley. As VC for Equity and Inclusion, Dania advances Berkeley's mission and goals by boldly establishing new paradigms and implementing strategies and tactics that further embed diversity, equity, inclusion, belonging, and justice practices into the fiber of the Berkeley campus. She is a visionary leader. If you've had the opportunity to spend even 2 minutes with her, you feel it. She's a strategic change maker who inspires as she leads. Prior to joining UC Berkeley, Dania served as the inaugural Associate Chancellor and Chief of Diversity Officer at UC Merced. Recently, Dania was named top DEI advocate and will be recognized at the 15th Annual California Diversity and Leadership Conference. She is a named fellow for the Hispanic Association of Colleges and University National Presidential Leadership Academy, La Academia de Liderazgo. And in 2018, she was named the top 25 women in higher education by Diverse Issues in Higher Education for making a difference in society, attacking some of higher education's toughest challenges, and exhibiting extraordinary leadership skills and making a difference in her respective communities. Dania received her JD from Catholic University Columbus School of Law and her AB from Brown University. She is also an affiliate faculty in critical in history and critical race and ethnic studies. Welcome, Dania. So I'm thrilled to get to be in conversation with you all again today. And I'd like to start my first question with Amy. Amy, UC Berkeley last held instruction in person in early 2020, and there have been many global and personal changes, traumas, and impacts since that time. In the last few weeks, we have welcomed back thousands of students and employees. What are your thoughts about where we are in the timeline of these impacts? Are we ready to restore?
Oh, well, I just have to say it's such an honor to be with this community today, having been in my office for a year and a half here. Oh, and there goes Apollo, who was joining me, my cat. Mari, thanks for the question, Mari. We, as a panel, kind of talked about this together as we were preparing, and we're sort of saying to each other, and I know you all, I assume you all must be feeling similarly, how can we be quite ready to restore at this point when we're so much still in recovery with COVID, not recovery, response mode with COVID? Some of us may feel like we're in that recovery stage, rebuilding stage, and some of us may not at all. We're kind of, we're back, but are we? Is sort of the question that looms over us. And I've been meeting with educators across the country, in California especially. I just was meeting with hundreds of educators yesterday online, and all the things that our very own Steve Sutton and others have mentioned this morning that are weighing us down, workload, hiring freezes, that sense of the lack of control makes it really hard to restore. So a couple of things to be aware of and to be mindful of right now. First of all, and I think we're doing that this morning, is just simply validating that with each other, suppressing it, holding it in, moving forward with, you know, we all strive for excellence at Berkeley, but yet to move forward and not really stop and cut ourselves some slack and our students some slack, and to really validate with each other that this is where we are and we're gonna be here for a while. And naming it is really important. We've talked about burnout, and there are so many reasons and causes for burnout right now. We've named some of them, but I think just to keep it brief, the more right now, one of the key characteristics of burnout is this lack of productivity and self-efficacy that we feel. We're detached if we're feeling burnout and we're exhausted. So one of the ways relationally, and I believe Steve Sutton mentioned this too, one of the ways relationally we can really support each other is to appreciate each other, like to find joy together with our pets, with our music, and to really appreciate each other as colleagues and students, and honor that and share our gratitude with each other. We need that right now, mm-hmm. as we're struggling to be productive.
Yeah, thank you, Amy. I really appreciate that. And Amy, you touched on burnout, but Michael, I'm hoping you can tell us a little bit about the biology of stress and the impact on health.
Yeah, Mari, thank you for that question. You know, since becoming dean, most people just ask me for money. So it's actually nice to get asked to talk about biology. So I guess I'll start by just drawing a distinction between good stress and bad stress, because I think, you know, they have different impact on health. So good stress is the kind of stress that you experience when you get invited to talk to 300-400 people. I'm pretty sure right now my blood pressure's up and my heart rate's up and I got adrenaline and catecholamines coursing through my veins right now. But I also know that in about half an hour, I'll be fine. You know, my blood pressure will have come down, my heart rate will have come down. In fact, I'll probably be feeling pretty good about being able to contribute to an important conversation to the betterment of our community. And I bet that's how many of you feel even after a long, hard day. Yeah, after you've been able to really help a student solve a housing problem or financial aid problem, or give the DACA student or a URM student a greater sense of belonging. So that's what good stress does, that it helps us, that it makes us better, it makes us stronger. And then there's bad stress, which is stress that just doesn't stop, it doesn't go away, it doesn't get better, and you just feel stuck. And whether that's being stuck in a thankless job or being stuck in an abusive relationship, we're being stuck in a racist society where there's just nowhere to run and nowhere to go, nowhere to hide from systemic discrimination. And over time, that chronic unrelenting stress can cause wear and tear on your body. The analogy I like to use that if you keep revving up the engine, over time, you're going to wear out the engine, right? If you keep riding the brakes, over time, you're going to wear out the brakes. So if your stress response is constantly turned on, over time, you're going to wear out those organs and systems that keep your stress response in check. And so that's your cardiovascular systems, that's your metabolic systems, that's your immune inflammatory systems, all the organs and systems that really help regulate your stress response. And that can lead to hypertension, diabetes, heart disease, and even premature death.
And so, Michael, during the next 10, 15 minutes that we have together, we'll keep talking about Restore, but can you give us a sneak peek of some of the things we could be doing at the individual and community level to tackle that stress and those stressors you're mentioning?
Yeah, so I think the key is to prevent from being stressed to being stressed out, right? I think stress might not be avoidable, but certainly being stressed out is certainly preventable. And there are certain things that individuals can do. Most of you know what they are. Sleep, exercise, eat right, meditation, mindfulness, cognitive behavioral therapy. But as a public health person, I think there's often too much focus on what individuals can and should do, and not enough attention to what the collective can do. Right? So how can we build a better workplace, have better working conditions that provide meaningful work in a supportive working environment to keep you from being stressed out? How do we build a more supportive community? So use that social support to buffer against the harmful effect of chronic stress. Or how do we build a more anti-racist organization or a more anti-racist society? And how do we really help dismantle institutionalized racism, given that it is probably at the root cause of many of the health disparities that we see in our society today?
Thank you, Michael. And that really resonates with what some of our earlier speakers, including Tobirus, Newby, mentioned earlier today. So I want to focus a little bit in on that community and that collective impact. Dania, when we spoke on Monday, you shared an adage that is connected to justice efforts of Native peoples as well as many marginalized communities. You said existence is part of the resistance. Can you tell us more about what this means to you and what we as a community should consider to move forward?
Thank you so much, Mari, and thank you to my fellow panelists for sharing the space. And thank you, Student Affairs, for just inviting that Mark Anthony as a Boricua. I really love hearing that. And what he talks about is, I'm gonna laugh, I'm gonna dance, I'm gonna live, I'm gonna live, right? And tying that into sort of both my lived and professional experience as someone who navigates identities with no structure being built for me, right? When I think of existence being resistance, my mere act of waking up, of breathing, right? Of stepping foot and stepping on that ground. I know you did the land acknowledgement when you thought that, but when we think about those structures, that is part of the resistance. That is part of being anti-oppressive, right? Being in those spaces and not only existing, which is enough. Oftentimes we focus on kind of the doing and the being and all of those things. And sometimes it's okay to just be, right? And I think that that's one of the pieces that we're really thinking about. We often use transformation in higher ed, and transformation looks that way, right? And that rest is a critical part of that. Right? That napping is the resistance, that resting, saying, I can, I won't, I will, right? All those different pieces are really, really critical to that. Because when you look at all the different overarching themes of kind of the capitalism, productivity, output, generative places, I always think about fill me up so I overflow. How you have to go inward first before you can pour out is really, really, really critical. And so for me, that's one of those places that I've always known and been and worked in structures, right? Criminal justice, higher ed, all of these systems of oppression. When I think of the development of transformative practitioners at UC Berkeley, it's people that engage in anti-oppressive thinking and action, and that could just be existing, right? And so one of those critical pieces for me does that. So as a community, how we put that together, right? And how we approach this and what we say in those spaces really, really matters, to just say that who you are and your being is enough. And all those places are really, really powerful. And so that's is what I think. And something I came to be, you know, I often wondered, you know, I'm the only, do they see what I see? Just that sort of psychological safety too, that we talk about. So existing and resisting and how we create a sense of belonging for our community is really recognizing that folks are navigating all of those spaces, and that part of psychological safety in those spaces is that recognition and that pace and that restoration.
Mm-hmm. Thank you, Dania. And I see the chat moving. So that tells me that folks are really resonating with the messages that you and the panel are sharing. Amy, I want to think about educators outside of the context of UC Berkeley. I know that you have an active project with some educators and leaders right now. What can we learn from that effort?
Thanks. I'm so glad we're talking about collective well-being versus individual well-being. As someone who's in the field of psychology and in education, our field tends to lean far too much on individual resilience. I appreciate, Dania, what you're saying about filling up and absolutely important, but I think in the field of psychology and education, we need to focus a lot less on individual grit and resilience and on the structures and community care that are in place. And so one of the things that we're doing right now within the education team of Greater Good Science Center is we actually have a FEMA grant to work with all of the county offices of education in California around mental health and well-being, social emotional well-being. And what we're doing is we're forming communities of practice with Sacramento and Orange County and all these other county offices. We're meeting together the adults, the leaders of the county offices, and we're practicing bridging differences. We're engaging in well-being practices. And we're integrating rituals into all of our staff meetings that are welcoming, that make people feel a sense of belonging. So a welcoming ritual, an engaging activity where everyone has a voice in the meeting in some way, and then some sort of an optimistic closure or a frame. Incorporating these structures, practicing modeling is really important from the top down, and doing that in a community sense. And the other great thing that Greater Good is doing right now, which is new for us, is that we have just launched a course called Bridging Differences, looking at checking our biases, our prejudices and assumptions, looking at how to navigate conflict. And that also is following a community of practice model. The leaders of the course are Allison Briscoe-Smith, professor, and Professor Rudy Mendoza Denton, and that class is free. So engaging in bridging differences and well-being practices together as adults, I think is the way to go, because then hopefully it filters down. And if we're engaging that way, then our students and other colleagues will as well.
Mm-hmm. And Amy, I really appreciate the examples that you gave, because sometimes when we think about structural inequities, it can feel really overwhelming. Yeah. To think about, well, what can I do today? And so you gave us some examples that all of us can incorporate into our meetings, into our committees, our task forces that we can use. And I do want to take a moment to sort of zoom out at that big structural lens. So Michael, a lot of our staff, particularly staff of color, are handling a lot of complex issues while simultaneously trying to support students. You've completed an analysis of historical injustices against the Asian American community. How do you balance that trauma and those stressors while also championing advocacy work for and with your communities?
No, I Yeah, I would just have to say that okay, whatever you do, don't do what I did for about 40 years. I think the way I've dealt with it was to repress it. Okay, all the pain and trauma from decades of prejudice and stereotypes and discrimination deep down in my psyche, right? Never talk about it, never complain about it. Just kept my head down, work harder than anyone else, just trying to prove my worth, trying to earn my place in the society. And just survival strategy, especially for first-gen immigrants, yeah, like me. But as I said before, I was wrong. That strategy only take you so far, and it has really contributed to the invisibility of anti-Asian racism in this country. And so I think a better strategy is to speak up and to speak out, and not just against anti-AAPI hate, but against all forms of hatred and bigotry and racism. Be an ally, become more anti-racist. And I think that's probably a better way to find that balance.
Thank you, Michael. And thank you for giving voice to that. As an immigrant, first gen, a queer woman of color, there's so much that I have held inside. And so to see you and Dania has also demonstrated this in her leadership, being authentic and vocal about the challenges in our various communities is deeply inspiring. I appreciate that. So Dania, I'm gonna start the last question with you and then hope that Amy and Michael can close us out. But this moment to restore presents a unique opportunity for transformation. What advice or considerations do you have for us to leverage the moment we're in and to bring us closer to the future and community we aspire toward?
Absolutely, Mari. Well, as you know, it's not a moment, it's a movement, right? And a movement that has really been in our society and our community cyclically for hundreds and hundreds of years, especially for many of us, as Michael talked about, all the antis, right, that we take on and we address. I take it back to being constantly curious about how power, privilege, and oppression work together, how the priority of the restoration is about shifting from that colonial concept of the individual to that collective well-being of the good. Because once we do that, we become okay with the ways that people need to self-preserve and take care of themselves, right? I think that oftentimes, especially the construct of the country, right? So I teach on the juridical history of the United States. You check a box and you get allocated resources. So the system wants that division, right? And so the more that we think about how we can do the coming together and that it's not us versus them, or if they get that, this group needs that. But how do we think about that collective well-being so that their restoration is a part of my own and a part of that collective will and good? And I think we have such an opportunity now. You know, I don't think they're completely there yet. I think there's pockets. I think COVID-19, which is still ongoing, right, has uncovered that for some, the reality that others have lived with their entire lives. And so having that curiosity and also shifting it to action. That's why I always link anti-oppressive thinking to anti-oppressive action. So how are we going to do that? How are we going to be? I know I am not the leader that I first started now in stretching this and really building in those spaces for myself. I have an amazing therapist. I have an amazing coach, right? So seriously, I think demystifying mental health, because I really having those pieces in place are a part of my restoration.
Thank you, Dania. Amy and Michael, what advice or considerations do you have for us?
I feel like Dania really said it all, but I do just want to say that it feels more like an opportunity to completely reorient rather than restore.
Thank you, Amy.
Oh, and I guess I'll just add, yeah. Be kind to each other, be an ally. When you see a colleague in need, when you see a colleague in pain, reach out. When you see microaggression and macroaggressions, speak up. I think there's only so much that you can push and stretch individual resilience. But the question is, how do we build stronger community resilience? How do we better support each other through these challenging times? And how do we help each other become a better version of ourselves as individuals, but also as a community?
Wonderful. Thank you so much for everything you've shared with us today. If we were in the room, I could tell you you'd hear a very loud round of applause and celebration from your colleagues. And I'm gonna turn it over to James now to close our event. Thank you again, panelists.
Thank you, Amy and Dania and Michael and Mari. I'm gonna pass it to Steve actually to close us out.
Wonderful. Well, wow, what an amazing event. I just really want to thank everyone for participating, being involved. Thank all of our wonderful speakers. I learned so much today. I'm going to really be thinking about this all day long and throughout the rest of the week and the weekend as I just continue to try to make meaning for myself about the things that we're dealing with today. So thank you so much to all of our speakers, our panelists, as well as our student performers and speakers and our planning committee. You know, these events don't just happen. We have lots of people behind the scenes that really are managing each and every detail. And so I have so much gratitude for them. And then we have others who've also provided support for this event. So thank you all so much for your participation. I hope you will continue to reflect on what we've talked about today and just think about how we will move forward in a positive way to serve our students and our campus and each other. Thank you again.
Take it in, but don't look down. 'Cause I'm on top of the world, hey.